Hello, and welcome to part one of Splunk's introduction to the security domain. In this first video, we will look at a few important events in history to help us understand how we got to the current state of security in this connected world. Let's get started. Do you recognize these people? Don't worry, I didn't either. On our left, Guglielmo Marconi was one of the inventors of the modern, now ancient, telegraph. It was 1903, and Marconi was giving a very important demonstration of his new wireless telegraph. This new technology could communicate with, for example, ships at sea. While they were expecting a message from their colleague 300 miles away, instead they received a message that, among other things, repeated the word rats. Yes, R-A-T-S, rats. What happened is that the British magician Neville Maskelyne, on the right, used a home-built 50-meter-long antenna to inject his signal into Marconi's transmission. With this, Maskelyne was proving that this new technology was not totally safe and private, as Marconi had recently claimed in a magazine. Some people disagree that Maskelyne's motivation was entirely for the public good, but even so, he proved there was a flaw in a system that was previously deemed safe and secure. While at this time this was called scientific vandalism, this is one of the first real hacks of the last century, and it is almost 120 years old by now. We are starting here to show you that, for as long as humans have existed, our curiosity and creativity have led us to create amazing technology, but also to figure out how to break it. Have you heard of phishing? Well, it started around the 50s or 60s, and it refers to the hacking of public telephone networks. One of its most famous incidents is when Joe Engrecia discovered that when he whistled at the phone, something happened on the line. His curiosity about the meaning of this led to the discovery that a tone, in a specific pitch, allowed access to certain operator functions. Exploiting this discovery could, for example, allow people to make free long-distance and international calls. Funny enough, John Draper later found that the whistle, distributed as a prize in the Captain Crunch cereal boxes in the 60s, would whistle in the exact pitch they needed to do this. This knowledge and more tools became more public in the 70s and 80s, and the phishing community grew. People got involved in many cases out of the desire of learning and experimenting, but that still led us to find a system flaw that could be exploited to gain something out of it. As phone and computer systems and networks matured, we continued to be curious and innovate. In 1988, Robert Tappan Morris developed a program to determine the size of the internet. His program would crawl the web, install itself on vulnerable computers, and count how many copies it made. Great idea, right? Because Morris assumed that some administrators may block his program from copying itself, he also configured it to copy itself a certain percentage of times, even if it was already present. The problem with this is that it turned an experiment into an infection. Self-generated copies of this program could eat up the memory of a machine and impact its performance up to the point of rendering it unusable. He, of course, didn't intend for this to happen, but still, his pet project became one of the first publicly known examples of a worm, which is a standalone malware that replicates itself so it can spread to other computers. By the way, he also got himself convicted of a felony under the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act of 1986. But that's a different story. What are we learning here? Vulnerabilities, in the wrong hands, can do a lot of damage. And that's something we saw in 2007. When a series of cyber attacks targeted websites of the Estonian parliament, banks, ministries, newspapers, broadcasters, telecom organizations, and energy companies, causing widespread outages. Without diving in the politics of this event, it definitely led to significant international law and procedure changes, as well as better guidelines on what defines cyber warfare. It was a good lesson on the significant potential for damage that can be caused by targeted infrastructure attacks. Technology continued to grow, and as people around the world continued to place more of their information online, the exposure and theft of personal and private information became more widespread. A cyber attack on Sony's PlayStation network in April 2011 claimed the personal information of 77 million users. 2 years later, 2013, an attack on Adobe that exposed user password and credit card information affected an estimate of 38 million users. And don't forget 2014, when 500 million Yahoo accounts were compromised. If by now you don't think your information is out there, you should go and sign up for Have I Been Pwned to confirm. Imagine you log into your computer and all your documents and pictures of your family and pets are unavailable to you. Instead, you get a message asking you to pay to restore your data, or otherwise it will be lost forever. That's harsh, right? Now imagine you're a business and this means you're unable to operate. Would you be prepared to recover from this? Well, this happened to an estimated 200,000 computers in more than 150 countries in 2017, when WannaCry was released into the wild. This outbreak had a massive impact across several industries and an estimated global cost of about $8 billion. The WannaCry ransomware CryptoWorm targeted computers running the Microsoft Windows operating system, encrypting data and demanding ransom payments in the Bitcoin cryptocurrency. While Microsoft had previously released patches to close the exploit, much of WannaCry's spread was from organizations that had not applied these patches or were using older Windows systems that were past their end of life. The attack was halted by the registration of a kill switch that prevented already infected computers from being encrypted or further spreading WannaCry. This was discovered by Marcus Hutchings, so thank you, Marcus. Unfortunately, ransomware is still a popular means of extortion. But only software can be compromised, right? Well, in 2015, Roe Hammer taught us that memory was vulnerable too. In 2018, Meltdown showed us it was possible to break the barrier between users and the OS, granting elevated privileges to any user. And Spectre proved it was possible to leak secrets from applications via side channel attacks on the processor. See? Anything we create, we can break too. Let's finish our history lesson with the 2022 discovery of a wide open vulnerability in Log4j. This is an old open source logging framework developed in 2001, and it is used in many Java applications. You might not have heard about Log4j, but you probably have heard of Java. This service can basically be told to call code from any location and then execute it on its host system, giving this vulnerability a perfect 10 in the common vulnerability scoring system. Due to the embedded nature of the Log4j library, it is not so easy to know everywhere it is running, but it has been observed in ovens, fridges, card readers, smart TVs, security cameras, cars, elevators, air conditioning and heating systems, and more. As you can imagine, official numbers of vulnerable and/or abused systems aren't easy to verify, but it's said that about 93% of all enterprise cloud environments were vulnerable, according to the cybersecurity consulting firm EY. Now, why did I take you on this trip down memory lane? There are two main things here in regards to security that I think are very important. First one, being aware that there is nothing, no system, no network that is truly safe. Somehow, some way, someone will find a way in. And this is not meant to cause panic, it's just meant for us to be alert and prepared. And number two, know that the more technology evolves, the more we rely on it, and the more connected we get, the higher the stakes are when security is compromised. You probably have been hearing more and more and more about cybersecurity or about security breaches and events. While there are many factors involved, it is also a natural evolution of how fast technology has grown and how fast we are adopting it into our lives. And as we continue to do that, it is also important that we all adopt and approach new technologies with security in our minds. And what does having security in our minds mean? Well, We'll talk about that in part 2 of our introduction to the security domain. Thank you for watching.